Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to Freedom on Deck on 94.9 News Now and Stimulating Talk. Me and Chet Martin here, joined as always by the Long Island redneck Brian Bro.
Let's get it going.
And the fearless C.V. Burton.
We mean what we say, and we say what we mean over here at Freedom on Deck.
And I am mean, to be quite frank with you. Got a lot going on. Just for a heads up, we got Dr. Carol Swain coming on from PragerU. We're going to be talking about Democrats' long history of racism. She is just a laundry list of achievements from this woman. So you're going to want to tune in to hear her. And then at the very end of the program, around segment 7, we have Josh and Nicole Landers coming by. We're going to be talking about that 9-year-old girl, little girl, that committed suicide. And then we're going to be finishing in the last segment also with Josh and Nicole. They're going to stick around with us just to speak with all of us about the Adam Lanza documents that came out, which were very, very disturbing. And a few days ago, don't forget, that was the anniversary of the shooting over in Connecticut in Newtown, where all those first graders perished due to a very sick human being that probably could have been stopped before anything ever occurred. And it's just another example of our institutional learning facilities not protecting our children.
Failing. Well, not only that, but our government failing as well. You know?
Yeah.
Bottom line.
Yeah, you can go tit for tat with the shooting in Newtown, and you can talk about the shooting in Parkland. All these shootings can be prevented, and it's not going to happen with stricter gun laws. What you have to do it with is education and protecting the kids. You have to put more protection into the schools.
You got to get rid of these HIPAA laws, man.
Absolutely.
You know, it's got to be mandated. You know, it's got to be reported to the NICS. It's got to be.
So over in Strasbourg, France, we had this Christmas attack in the market. And it was a 29-year-old piece of crap named Sharif Shakat, who is a Muslim. Can I say that? Is that all right to... Can we talk about the fact that it was a Muslim?
You can't say that.
It was a Muslim that was not native-born to France. He had been on a terrorist watch list. They had multiple incidents where this guy... He actually got arrested for a stabbing. He had committed robberies multiple times. He was on a terrorist watch list, like I said. And, of course, nothing's done. And then, years later, because he was on a terrorist watch list, but they put him on the watch list back in 2009.
Yeah.
So he's been on it since he was 20. Wow. Longer than that. Yeah, no, since he was 20. So this guy, even though he's been on a terrorist watch list for that long, commits more crimes after that, and they still don't do the right thing and put him away for life.
Yeah.
And then he goes out and he kills 2 people. He injures 11. And finally, he gets killed himself when he goes over to Germany. He flees to Germany. And if you look at all the riots that are going on right now in France, now it's erupted in Sweden. We got them all over in Europe happening right now. And what the media doesn't want to tell you is a lot of it is because of this mass influx of refugees coming in that don't belong there, and the people have had it because of things like this.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
All right, so what do you guys think about terrorism in the Western world right now and what's happening in conjunction with these riots that are uprising from the citizens? Where is this going right now?
I think it's going exactly where it should be. I think that the people of free worlds and free countries should be rising up against the globalists and these leaders that are part of that network. You know, that's what's going on. You have the EU is, let's face it,
it's PU.
It's it's been infiltrated by globalism, and you know this open borders, you know, nonsense. Look at Hungary. Hungary's like, nope, not going to be a part of your open border society, and they put up fencing along their borders, and they are securing their borders, and they're not taking in refugees, and they're talking about sanctions against the country and all this other stuff. And I think that the people are waking up. You know, people are waking up. And, you know, in Sweden, you got a 9-year-old little girl that was raped. Okay, her mother was not far off, but she was playing on a playground. And apparently the guy raped her. He was a Muslim migrant and raped this 9-year-old little girl on this playground. And it wasn't until the little girl came running and got away from this man after he had carried out his act that she realized what was going on.
Right.
And in Sweden,
and it's going on all over Sweden.
Oh, yeah, of course.
They're not allowed to report it in Sweden. You're not allowed to talk about it in Sweden. You can get arrested if you say the wrong thing against Muslims in Sweden.
Well, the people of Sweden, I think, have had enough.
Oh, yeah.
Because it's a part of their culture. It's a part of their culture to rape kids. So if you bring them in, you're inviting that into your culture. And don't forget, over in Sweden, you're not allowed to arm and protect yourself. Mm-hmm. They're not allowed to... they don't have their Second Amendment rights over there.
Let me tell you something about old school Norwegians and Swedish.
Where are they?
They didn't need guns back in the day because conquered half the world.
Well, where are they?
Where
have they gone?
Where are the men now?
The men are wearing Daisy Dukes and transgendering over in Sweden.
Yeah.
That's where they are. Yeah. They're not having kids. They've turned into lily whites.
I don't think all of them. I don't think you can classify all of them.
Well, they better stand up. I think
what it takes is oftentimes I believe this is absolutely true, is it's the same reason that we don't have that going on right here in our country right now. Okay, and we have an armed population.
Yeah.
It's because they haven't been pushed back far enough. They haven't their backs are not against the wall. Here in America,
not yet.
The way they are in Sweden, in Norway, in Denmark, in France, in England, in Ireland.
Well, that's because they have the boot of the EU on their throats.
Right, and they're finally getting sick of it.
Which is controlled by the UN.
You know, it's just that like you said it, and you said it last week, that gas tax was just the straw that broke the camel's back.
Absolutely.
It was, there have been many, many things that are going on in that country, and... in many countries in Europe that have caused what is going on.
You're not supposed to say the straw that broke the camel's back anymore. PETA said.
Oh.
PETA said.
Well, we know that. Well, we know
that anymore.
Well, we know that was
this guy Sharif. Going back to this terrorist, you know, I saw the pictures of his body after he was shot. He definitely has the Zibaba mark on his forehead. If you know what that is,
no.
The sign. That practice the Islamic prayers 5 times a day, that shows that his terrorist attack that he portrayed was done by a devout practicing Muslim. That's it. So when they tell you that these people are not practicing Muslims, that they are mentally unstable.
Lies.
Well, then these are mentally unstable people that are being allowed
Lies.
Into these Muslim churches.
Lies.
Yeah. I know it's a lie.
It's just the same way that you have these imams that are preaching, you know, going into the countries and mating and having children with their women and their daughters.
Oh, yeah. Right here in America, they're saying this under the shroud of Islam.
You can't say it.
There's a lot of fake news going on in Europe, you know, with that straw that broke the camel's back. It's supposed to be about gas tax. It wasn't, probably, that was the least of their problems was the gas tax. But it's the fake news media. And again, with the fake news media in this case, they're trying to say he was radicalized in prison as if, you know, Muslims are quite fine, you know, until they get radicalized.
Yeah, right. All right, folks, listen, come on back. We're going to be talking about old Bobby Mueller. Their team scrubbed Peter Strzok's phone. You don't want to go anywhere. Can you believe this? Foul play at the top levels. Come on back to Freedom on Deck. Wow.
Welcome back to Freedom on Deck, 94.9 News Now and Stimulating Talk. That's FOD to you. Don't forget to go to freedomondeck.com. Look at all we have to offer for you there. Our midweek podcast has been on a little hiatus for the last month, but it'll be back. And you can go to all our backtracks that are all there for you. There are links for Facebook, for Twitter, for BitChute. Subscribe to BitChute. That's really important to us. And also subscribe over to YouTube if you want. I called into Lee Elsie a few days ago. It's the ever-growing popularity in Lee Elsie, the big national host who does some work for the Wayne Allyn Root Show War Now. And that seems to be happening for him more and more. So I look forward to it every time he covers for Wayne. And I think there are bigger things headed for Lee Elsie.
Oh, yeah.
But I called the other day, and we kind of got into a few different topics. We got into the transgender Santa Claus, which is really taken off. 27% of Pittsburgh folks polled over there believe that Santa should be transgendered. And real Pittsburgh. Important stuff. Yeah, right. So this is interesting stuff. But anyway, we eventually got into what's going on with the special counsel involving Bob Mueller, headed by Bob Mueller, which is digging the heels in Cohen, who pleaded guilty and was sentenced. And first of all, before I get into what Mueller did, Cohen pleads guilty and then afterwards is on a national TV program doing an interview. When has that ever happened before?
You know,
he's doing an interview with Step on All of Us all of a sudden.
And not only that, but you know, he's going to like a country club resort of a person.
Oh yeah, he's being taken care of.
It's like, give me a break.
And they're treating this guy like he's pure as the driven snow. He's obviously he's been a liar the whole time.
Yeah, exactly. Well, listen, I mean, I'm no fan of Cohen, but I would like to know why John Edwards gets the free pass. When he was taking money, hush money for his mistress while his wife was dying of cancer in a hospital bed.
And while he was in office.
Oh, yeah.
Don't forget, Trump wasn't in office when all this happened.
Correct. And the other thing is, and he used his own money.
If it was from campaign finances, we would know that by now.
Correct.
That didn't happen.
And, you know, and they're going after him for the biggest thing is his taxes. Not paying taxes, tax fraud, right? So it's like, wait a second. How come Al Sharpton gets the pass? Doesn't he owe like $4 or $5 million to the IRS?
A lot.
This guy still has a freaking TV program. You're telling me he ain't got the millions to pay it?
Of course he does. But he's a good Democrat.
He gets the pass.
So leading into this now, the office of the special counsel actually deleted text messages from the iPhone of Peter Strzok before it was turned over to the Department of Justice the Inspector General. And this comes from a report released by the federal watchdog. Now, this means when Bob Mueller got a hold of this phone, probably Strzok had deleted the messages, but you still have the internal memory, you have the cloud. You have all these ways that you can get the messages if you want to, but he made sure that it was, as Hillary would say, wiped with a rag.
I mean, you don't think the NSA has them?
I would think they probably do. If they want to get a hold of them, they can. Right. The point isn't whether Mueller could get a hold of them. The point is that Mueller wanted to get rid of them.
Correct.
Mm-hmm. Now, if somebody is conducting an investigation into Donald Trump and his business and the people surrounded by Donald Trump, why would it be okay to know when you know that there is bias from the investigators that work under you or at the time worked under James Comey for you to take their devices, which you know they were using, talking biasly about Hillary Clinton and Donald Trump, and deciding to wipe it clean like
because,
that.
Because the FBI has, you know, they have that little unheard and unspoken notion that you never go after your own. Do you think that they're going to bury themselves Do you think that they are going to shoot themselves in the foot, discredit themselves, make themselves look like they're incompetent or that they are crooked? No. No, they are not going to do that. And even if it means giving Strzok and Page the pass in order to take down Donald Trump, that is what Mueller is prepared to do.
Well, CV, Congress has to step in here because we smell the rat. If they knew the evidence was on the device and the device was handed over after he was fired from the Russian investigation, then they're in cahoots.
There's only a handful of congressmen that have any kind of spine at all, and a lot of them are never Trumpers, and so you can't count on them. So there's no justice in our Justice Department. This really leads back to Obama, and I've always said that, you know, way back before the 2016 election, I always said Obama will never leave office peacefully, and I was right. He did not leave peacefully. He didn't leave at all. All these people in the Justice Department, Mueller, Strzok, Rosenstein, all of these people are Obama operatives. Make no mistake about it. This is a banana republic that we've become.
Well, let me ask you this though: the you had Congress that have put subpoena after subpoena after subpoena for information, for evidence,
and they don't come out with
it. They never deliver.
Yeah.
So what can Congress really do? What is their actual power?
They never do anything.
What is their actual power? Can they put a warrant for the arrest of Mueller or whoever is not complying with their... If you were subpoenaed by a judge to be in court and you didn't show up, what would happen next? A warrant would be issued for your arrest.
Absolutely.
And then you would appear in court. Right. How come it's any different for these different branches of government?
You know,
because they control the narrative.
You know, people who have like inside connections, like John Solomon, Joe DiGenova, they all say it's all going to come out in the wash. These people are going to see justice sooner or later, and it's starting to heat up, and they're starting to feel the heat, and they're starting to panic, and that's why they're making all these crazy moves. You know, with Cohen and this, that, and the other thing.
Wait till you hear our guest next week, Mr. Milkovich, coming on by.
Yeah,
he wrote this book, Bob Mueller, and I can't think of the full name of the book. I'm sorry, it's not in front of me right now.
I think it's like Mueller, the errand boy
of the NWO, the New World Order. Yes. Right, right. You wait till what he has to say, and all the ties that Bob Mueller has really been, and Gordon and Christine for Justice for All that comes on before us on Sundays, they talk about this all the time. They call him the fixer.
Yeah.
Because he was brought in after 9/11, which we know some hokey things happened during 9/11.
Yep.
He was brought in after Benghazi. And he was also had those ties that we've talked about with Whitey Bulger when he was heading up the FBI in Boston.
He's a crook.
So we're going to be talking about all those things next
week.
Listen.
Most people can kind of judge and have a good, you know, judgment of people's character.
He is a crook. You hit it a nail on the head.
Look at his face.
Yeah, look at his face.
Yeah.
Those jowls on the side of his face.
Look at Strzok's face.
Oh, Strzok, yeah.
No, both of them. I'm saying Mueller.
Mueller is very Nixonian looking.
Look.
He is very Nixonian.
Look at these people. Look at them. Look at their facial expressions. I mean, it's in the eyes. It's in the face, man. Body language.
The Obama administration meant to take our nation down, to dilute its power and its sovereignty. So that's why Mueller and all these cats, they're all take the side of our enemies. Every time they take the side of our enemies. Mueller was involved with Uranium One. Talk about Russia collusion.
There's another one for you. Mueller is just another NWO puppet. Listen, folks, for all you liberals that don't like us saying that too damn bad, come on back, because we've got Dr. Carol Swain coming on from PragerU, and we're talking about the Democrats' long history of racism. There was no switch. Come on back to FOD. Welcome back to Freedom on Deck on 94.9 News Now and stimulating talk. You're rocking with the best in Connecticut, Long Island, and Rhode Island. WJJF on your FM dial, folks. Go to freedomondeck.com. Check out everything we have to offer for you there. It's a one-stop shop for all your patriotic needs. Now, the first guest to today's program is a conservative television analyst and former professor of political science and law at Vanderbilt University. She is the author of 8 books. Her scholarly work has been cited by 2 associate justices in the Supreme Court, and she's featured in the 2016 smash hit documentary by Dinesh D'Souza, Hillary's America. And make sure to go and check out Be the People's News blog and podcast at BeThePeople'sNews.com. Dr. Carol Swain, welcome to Freedom on Deck, Dr. Swain.
Hey, it's my pleasure.
It's my pleasure to have you on. I'm a big fan. And, you know, you have a new ebook that's on the works, and it'll be released later, I believe later this month, called From Democrat to Republican, A Southern Black Woman's Journey to Freedom. Now, tell our listening audience a little bit about this ebook.
Well, I was asked to write the ebook by my Facebook followers. We surveyed them to see what they would like to learn more about, and they wanted to know about my journey. And it caused me to think about my childhood and sort of work my way to the point that I left the Democratic Party. And as part of that, I had to think about when I became a Democrat. When did I realize I was a Democrat? And thinking about my family, we never talked about politics. And so the ebook is very short. It's going to be given away free on my website in a couple of weeks. And it's my story of being a Democrat, not really knowing why, watching the Democrats, becoming disillusioned, and finally walking away. And I sort of urge people to run away. But to me, I think that a lot of people are in the Democratic Party, but they don't know why.
Right.
And that was me.
Well, that's just, you know, it's kind of like you're born into it, right? So you never really question it until you start realizing this is not who I am, not my values. I'm a former Democrat. So, you know, I went through that. My whole family, Democrats. My father, God rest his soul, Democrat. My mother, Democrat. She even worked for Gene Kennedy Smith. And, you know, one day I just said, that's not me, you know, and it wasn't. But Dr. Swain, I wanted to discuss a video featuring yourself put out by PragerU, and it's gotten so many hits. You know, I was telling you before we came on the air that, you know, it's like hundreds of millions of views if you add them up from all these different pages, in which you discuss the inconvenient truth about the Democrat Party, in which you explain how the Democrats were the party of slavery and the Republican Party was the party that wanted to abolish slavery. Most of us understand that President Lincoln was a Republican, but can you give our listening audience more information about the truths on both parties' backgrounds with civil rights and racial equality?
Well, first of all, the Democrats are not just the party of slavery and the KKK. The KKK was sort of like their enforcement arm. They were the terrorists, and they were Democrats, but they were the party of segregation. And I was born and raised in Virginia. And Virginia was a state where there was massive resistance to integration that lasted up until the end of the 1960s, and that was Democrat. And again, I didn't realize that until I started doing my research, that Virginia, you know, went kicking and screaming into integration. They fought Brown versus Board of Education, the case, the 1954 case, the year I was born, that ordered schools integrated. And so the Democratic Party has always pushed segregation. And if you look at what's happening now at our colleges and universities, that many of the colleges are having separate black graduations. They are allowing separate black dorms and are really into separatism. And there was an article a few weeks ago about these high-priced vacations that some black people are going on. The vacation promises them, time away from white people. They will be able to enjoy themselves without encountering any white people. And I find it interesting that black people would be so willing to go along with segregation when the civil rights leaders fought so hard for integration.
It is amazing. Now, Carol, being that said, why do so many black Americans lean left when you have this disgusting background in the Democrat Party? And was there a switch in the 1960s?
Well, you know, people had the arguments there was a Southern strategy and that the Republicans decided to go after the Southern racist vote. And they don't actually accuse them of using overt racism, but they would say that they use taxes and coded language about welfare and various things like that. And the party switched. The Democrats became the party of civil rights, and the Republicans pretty much became the party of racism. And there was no big switch. And one of the things I learned researching for this ebook that I'm about ready to release is that when Virginia elected its first Republican governor since Reconstruction, it was 1969, and they did it as a rejection of the segregationist Democrats that had led the massive resistance to integration. So Virginia voters wanted nothing to do with the segregation that came from the Democrats. So in 1969, they elected a Republican governor. According to the people that argue that there was this big switch, they argue that Republicans got elected, you know, because the people, they appealed to race and the people voted for them because of their racism. And nothing could be further from the truth in Virginia, a state that I know because I was born and raised there.
Dr. Swain, was there any one moment of clarity, you know, where you sort of had an epiphany? And if so, what was that one moment?
I can tell you that I started questioning the differences between the parties back in the early 1990s. But I didn't become a Republican until 2009. And some of it had to do with research on one of my books, the book that won the national prizes, Black Faces, Black Interests. I traveled around with black and white members of Congress, and I got to see what was going on up close, and it was very clear to me that a lot of the black leaders were not doing a very good job of representing their constituencies, and that that some white representatives were doing a better job. And I also felt that it was not a good position for blacks to be in, the position that 94-95% of the black community in one political party. I knew that strategically it made sense for blacks to be in both political parties so that you would always have someone at the table when discussions take place. But I myself did not have enough courage to make that party switch. And I don't know. I really think it was a question of courage, because in my heart and mind, I saw problems with the Democratic Party, but for years, and it's the same today, that when you are a black Republican, you are viewed with suspicion. You're seen as a sellout. And I guess back in those days, I was just not ready for that baggage that would come, or the ostracism. And so I did not make the switch until 2009, but in 2000, I became a devout Christian believer. My values as a Christian sort of clashed against the values of the Democratic Party, and I started calling myself an independent. So I was a Democrat for most of my life, then I was an independent for 4 or 5 years, and then finally in 2009, I made the decision to come out as a Republican.
We have Dr. Carol Swain on with us. She's you can hear her on Be the People's News podcast, and you can read her on Be the People's News blog, and that's check that out at bethepeoplesnews.com. She's also got an ebook coming out a little later this month, From Democrat to Republican, A Southern Black Woman's Journey to Freedom. Now, Dr. Swain, with what you just brought up, when everything went down with Kanye West this year, after he announced that he was a Trump supporter. He kind of backtracked on that, but let's go back to when he made that announcement. And eventually met the president at the White House. He actually received death threats. He was shamed by his fellow black musicians and called names by Democrats that are racist in nature. Was this tact of shaming minorities supporting Republicans created by the left?
I mean, it's been going on forever.
Right.
And so, yeah, I would say that it was created by them, but it's not just black people shaming black people. It's white liberals who think that they somehow are morally superior to everyone else. And when they are attacking a black person, they get a free pass. They can say anything. And they get away with it.
And these words that they use, I can't say them as a white man, but some of them are very offensive in nature. I mean, you know, have you ever been directed these comments to for switching?
Well, I mean, I've been called Aunt Jane. That's Uncle Tom's counterpart.
Okay.
And a sellout. And when I published my book, Black Faces, Black Interests, The Representation of African Americans in Congress, I was a Democrat, but I argued, that political party was more important than the race for the representative, and if black tell the views they did, they'd best be represented by Democrats. And because I said political party was more important than race, I was attacked, I was called a sellout, and that was when, I was a Democrat. I lost my standing. I was accused of being a conservative. I was ostracized then by the black community because I said that whites could represent blacks and blacks could represent whites, and that representation was more than skin color. And that was something that was considered controversial. That was when I first started getting called conservative. And being called a conservative or being called a Republican, I mean, it can severely damage a career.
It's sad because, you know, you've had quite a career. And
I know
I saw that you were attacked at Vanderbilt by some people that wanted you to step down. I know you retired yourself, but I think for a black American that's accomplished as much as you have, you should be applauded, and we do applaud you, and we applaud great Americans like Dr. Ben Carson, but they label us as the racists when we're not the one promulgating the idea of pitting races against each other.
I mean, they're not just pitting races against each other. You know, they are trying to destroy the blacks that have been successful because they're individualists. There's no place for an individualist among the left.
That's absolutely true, Dr. Swain.
You either go along with the group or you're out.
Dr. Swain, I want to give you plenty of ample time here to tell everybody.
And by the way, some people would argue that I'm not really black.
Okay.
Because to be black, you have to think in a particular kind of way.
Right, right. Let everybody know about the ebook again and when it's coming out, and also about the website to go check out in order to get your blog and podcast as well.
Well, later this month, I will be releasing a short ebook that will be downloadable free. It's From Democrat to Republican, A Southern Black Woman's Journey to Freedom. And it'll just tell the story of my little bit about my background, my time in academia, and how I came to the realization that I needed to leave the Democrat Party. And that I will announce on social media. You can follow me on Facebook at Professor Carol M. Swain, or Twitter at Carol M. Swain, and I will announce when the book is available for free download. And it will be a short book. You can read it in an hour or so, 4,500 words.
Excellent, excellent, everybody. That was Dr. Carol Swain, and we appreciate her coming by. Great stuff there. We're going to be coming back with Trump. Had a little meeting with Chucky Boy Schumer and Nasty Nancy, and he told them what he thought about their antics. We're going to build that wall, folks. Come on back to Freedom on Deck. Welcome back to FOD. Right here on your FM dial, WJJF, 94.9 News Now, and Stimulating Talk. Chet Barton, CV Burton, Brian Bro, and you. Thank you for being here with us. Make sure that you go watch you some Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer while you're listening to Baby It's Cold Outside. And anything else that offends liberals out there on the Christmas season, please do it. Did you see that Facebook, they marked it as a violent image that they took off, and it's Santa kneeling with the baby Jesus. They called it violent imagery.
It's violent.
It violated their community standards.
What standards?
So
Facebook, Zuckerberg has standards. Didn't he steal Facebook from his from one of the co-founders?
His standards are to shut us down. That's
people
that guy's a jerk.
People laughed when Donald Trump said the war on Christmas, but let me tell you something. It gets worse every year, and thank God we got President Trump.
Dude,
forget about it.
I go to people's houses. They say, Happy Holidays. I say, Merry Christmas.
Absolutely.
And then, you know, some people, because they're trying to be politically
then
correct.
They'll say Merry
then
Christmas.
Then they'll say, oh, yes. Merry Christmas, and their face lights up, and you're like, don't be spineless. Just
right.
Say Merry Christmas.
Say what you want to say.
I did see a really good post. It said we should just like condense all the winter solstice holidays into one. Just call it winter consolidation season or holiday. winter consolidation holiday.
Well, that was like, I don't know if you guys, and we'll get into the topic real quick here, but I don't know if you guys saw, they made this PC version of Baby It's Cold Outside. It's hilarious. You gotta see it if you haven't seen it. And it's done in a mocking way. You know, she's like, well, I really should go. And he's like, you're more than free to do so.
Yeah, he's like, please go outside.
Exactly. So anyway, we also what happened in the meeting with Chuck, Nancy, and President Trump. And the mainstream media, let me get to this before I start reading from the article. The mainstream media edited that meeting between Chuck, Nancy, and President Trump to a point where it was like a bad butcher job. It was like
horrible.
Cut up. And right here on this station where when Donald Trump would make a point, they'd edit it out almost to make him look bad.
Oh, absolutely. Obviously. Absolutely. I was watching the news, Channel 2 News in the morning, just because I can't stomach most anything else. And they did the same thing.
Right.
I mean, we're a CBS affiliate anyway, but I mean,
yeah.
But they did the same thing. And I mean, and just like you said, totally disparaging because, you know, for most of us, and I think people that are listening to this radio show right now, you know, you're on the up and up. You're probably on social media to a pretty good level. You probably have friends and family that are sending you these videos as well. So you probably saw the full length video first.
Yeah.
Cause it came right out.
Right.
And then you see the news cycle the next day or the next morning when you're drinking your coffee and you're just going like, really? Come on.
I love the meme where Chuck's looking down between his legs and Donald's like, Chuck, you don't have any balls. Nancy has bigger balls than you.
Oh no, this one even better than that. Remember when Amy Schumer did the nude photo with her on the stool,
and it's
Donald Trump holding up that picture, and he says, "Look at it, Chuck."
That's pretty good.
That's awesome.
But anyway, so they get into this discussion in front of the world, which is great. And Nancy complains that they need to do it in private, and President Trump CV says, no, this is what did he say again, Brian? He said,
no,
this is transparency.
Yeah, when she said, oh, let's have a meeting behind closed doors where we could really talk. And he said, no, Nancy, this is good. It's called transparency. And, you know, and he's right. And I think the reason he did it, and I saw a really good article that talks about how Donald Trump set three traps. And basically, you know, he got Schumer and her to on TV say that there's no need for the wall.
Right.
Got them to say on TV that they needed to speak behind closed doors in order to get anything done. So it shows that they're being crooked. And I forget what the third point was, but I mean, I'm telling you, it's a really good article if you just Google it and look it out there.
I've shared it already. I read it. It's an opinion piece.
And it's a good opinion piece. And I'll tell you what, he's right. And Donald Trump is smart. He knows how to set these traps. He knows how to handle drama. He's a reality TV host and creator. He knows what he's doing. Yeah. And you know, the fact that, you know, what was the other thing point I made to you between segments that he set up on them?
I don't know, but listen, Nancy Pelosi, you want to talk about being non-transparent? This is the woman that said we had to pass Obamacare before we could read what was in there.
That was the other one. The Obamacare. He knew that by giving, when he did the tax cuts and they put the part of the tax cut was repealing the individual mandate. Once the individual mandate was removed, he knew it. I'm sure they got attorneys. I'm sure the heads of the Republican Party knew that once they pulled that out of there was nothing constitutional about the law anymore, and they knew that it would set up a challenge.
Well, you know, Trump wanted to make sure this was transparent and in front of the cameras because they would have done two things. First of all, they would have mischaracterized everything Trump said, and the lamestream, leftstream media, whatever you want to call it, would have been, you know, playing right along with that, with their propaganda, and they would have mischaracterized everything Trump was presenting. So it was great that Trump, you know, did this in public. And the other thing that they wanted to do was to make their backroom deals. You know, you give us this, we'll give you that. We'll take this, we'll do this for you. But the thing is, Trump should get as much as he can possibly get out of this, and then take the rest out of the military budget, which is like $700 billion. They could afford, you know, like $10 billion out of that as well.
Yeah. And he said he will do that.
Yeah.
If need be.
And he will, yes.
Go ahead. And you know, the thing, it shows you that the Democrats don't give a rat's rear end about it protecting the American people, because you think you'd make some concessions and come with some middle ground and say, yes, let's work on a border wall that we can both agree on. Meanwhile, let's talk about, and I don't want to talk about it, but they do, DACA or whatever's on their plate to get a little more going for them. But instead of being able to, you know, work with the man, instead they have to just, you know, totally cripple the process, which is embarrassing. And you know what? As far as I'm concerned, the wall needs to get built, and we need to get on it now because we're going to run out of time. But listen, we're going to be coming back. And we're going to be doing another topic here because our guest is coming on later. And we're talking about the terrorist funding migrant caravan. That's right. There is a terrorist that bombed some of our soldiers. And he is now behind one of the caravans that made its way to Mexico. And we're also going to be talking about Mexico shutting down their borders. Come on back. Welcome back, folks. Freedom on Deck. WJJF 94.9 News Now and Stimulating Talk. Rocking on a Sunday. Thank you for being here with us. Only a couple days until Christmas. I hope everybody's ready out there. Hope you're going to the mall and visiting your local transgender Santa Claus. It's another thing we were talking about with Lee. There actually is a Santa Claus in Lancaster, Pennsylvania. That is transgender, and the kids go and visit and sit on his or her lap. It's good stuff out there right now. And the new book, Santa's Got a New Husband, was just released. It's a cartoon illustration. So Black Santa and White Santa shagged up together, so that's going on. All this good holiday fun.
Leave Santa alone.
Leave everything alone. We're going to be talking about that after this topic. Usually we have our second guest, but Josh is coming on our seventh segment and hanging around for our eighth segment because he's got, we're going to be talking about things that are close to his heart, so we're kind of skipping the guests for this topic, but we're going to be talking about a terror suspect in a U.S. troop bombing, and he is one of the migrant caravan organizers, and his name is Alfonso Guerrera Ulloa, I believe. It's U-L-L-O-A. If I'm saying that wrong, I'm sorry. But he's originally from Honduras, and he was granted political asylum back in 1987 and has lived in Mexico for the past 30 years, three decades. Seated at the El Baratel shelter, Guerrero joined the migrant caravan in Corabo, just south of Mexico City, in November 4th of 2018. Now, most of you probably know about the news story where many of the migrants were demanding $50,000 in order to go back to their land of heritage, which would probably be Honduras, El Salvador, and these areas when they got into Tijuana. But he was the organizer that brought that caravan down to Tijuana that made those demands. He's a terror suspect, okay? I'm trying to look for what he did and when he did it.
He planted a bomb in a Chinese restaurant.
Okay,
yeah.
Here it is.
Six U.S. in Honduras.
This, yeah. And from the New York Times reported that he was suspected to be named behind the August 87 incident in which a bomb was planted in a Chinese restaurant in Honduras, injuring six United States troops and a Honduran citizen. He should not be out there, but he is. And
yeah, but to be also clear, and just, you know, because I think this is an important aspect, he fled to Mexico where he received permanent asylum. That's a big issue.
Yeah.
Because that right there, now I understand Mexico in 1987 was a little different than now, but look at the problems we still have with Mexico today. Now, I know they got a new president. I know the new president is seeing the light a little bit. I understand that they closed down their southern border.
They closed down their border with Guatemala.
Correct.
Because we weren't taking in the trash that went into their country.
Correct.
So they said, now we have a problem.
Correct. Yeah. So the people, like you said, Tijuana and these border cities are, you know, they're basically going back to Mexico government and saying, hey, you know, you got to do something for us here.
Right.
You know, did you see the pictures of how they left Tijuana?
Oh, yeah. It looked like
a toilet bowl.
It did. It looked like a toilet bowl.
It looked like 10,000 people came, took a dump on it, on the city, and left.
They were used diapers in the streets. Like you said, feces in the streets, hypodermic needles, CV.
Yeah, that wakes you up.
Beer bottles. And then they said, well, United States not going to take them? We better do something about our border wall with Venezuela.
So now this guy is funding the caravan and demanding $50,000 a head.
A pop.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's a big scheme. Like that was going to happen anyway. Yeah. He's funding them with Soros' money!
Yep.
And you morons think that we don't need a wall! Chuck and Nancy, you've got a terrorist not only in the caravan, but funding it.
And he's been wanted by the United States for years. And the document that was put out back in 1987 by the United States government accused the Mexican government of harboring him in spite of international law, and further called on Mexico to turn Guerrero over to the government of Honduras.
Mm-hmm.
Because then we could have gotten him from Honduras. But Mexico did not do that.
It's unbelievable. I'm officially recognizing the Democrat Party as a terrorist group.
It is a terrorist group.
Yeah.
It has been for a long time, and believe
did,
me.
Did you hear that Beto O'Rourke's campaign
Beto?
Was caught on Project Veritas on a hidden video, giving campaign funds to the caravan.
Yes,
using prepaid cards.
Yep.
To buy supplies. Unbelievable.
Yeah,
this guy's gonna get. He should get busted big time for this. Talk about Donald Trump.
You know, good on a Tuesday evening, the National Border Patrol Council Vice President Art Del Cueto was on with Elizabeth McDonald on the evening edit following the White House meeting between Trump and Pelosi and Schumer. And here's what Cueto said. I heard some of the words they said earlier today, and they were attacking the president, attacking the wall. And you know what? Nancy Pelosi and Schumer can come down here and help us patrol the border, and I'll show them how difficult and how dangerous it really is and how the wall makes a difference. So he's saying, come on down, look at the areas where we actually do have a wall and that it does make a difference, but look at the job we do and that our Border Patrol agents are in danger. Yeah. And these are American citizens, Nancy. And I guarantee you, Chuck and Nancy live behind walls every day of their single life.
Yep.
Their big pearly gates and their marble mansions.
And their security guards with guns.
But not us, though.
No.
We can't have that. What do you think, Brian?
I think that, look, you have a problem here in this country. And we kind of talked about it, you know, before we started the show. And that's, you know, we elect a president, we elect certain Congress, we elect a certain Senate, and then somewhere the American people think that a gridlocked government is the best choice. So now you have the Democrats taking control of the House, and you're never going to see a border wall unless they do something before. If they fund it now. That's the problem that we have in this country. Why don't we want our country to move forward and solve problems? And there's only one reason, and that's because the American people are too stupid to wake up from their phones or their day-to-day lives and realize that if you do not have some sort of consistency in the government, you're never going to have a free and prosperous society that we want to have.
Well, and the mainstream media, which most people suckle up to the teat on.
That's true.
We know many of
them say
to themselves, well, you know, the mainstream media, Wolf Blitzer tells me that if we don't have these migrants coming in, we won't fill these certain jobs. We won't, you know, they actually contribute to our economy, which is absolute ludicrous bull. Half of them that come in, more than half, probably 80% of them are on welfare. Probably 80% of them get government aid and rip from our veterans. I hear this moron De Niro going on Twitter and saying, we can help them at the same time when we help the veterans. We should do both. Well, we can't do both. We can't even do one. We haven't even been taking care of the veterans, period. So how are we going to do that? How are we going to help both when we can't help the ones that live here and have made the ultimate sacrifice for this country?
Who have paid, who have served, who have paid the taxes, who have contributed to the society already.
Right.
Who have helped build this nation.
Yeah. Right.
And if we need more people to contribute to our society, there is something called legal immigration.
Correct.
Which should be merit-based. Wolf Blitzer, you idiot.
There's a big line, Wolf. There's a big line, Jake, that these folks that really want to come in to prosper in America as Americans, not as Mexicans, not as El Salvadorians, not as Guatemalans, which these people do, because when you see them coming in these caravans, they're waving their flags, they're singing their national anthem. They're not singing our national anthem. They're not waving our flags. They're burning them.
I want to give you a number. We take in 1 million people approximately a year, a little over, okay? But just say 1 million. You divide that by 365 days. We take 2,740 people a day.
Legally?
Legally.
Right. So that's
a day.
More than enough.
Almost 3,000 people a day come into this country legally. And we want all these millions of illegal immigrants coming in who we don't know.
The Democrats
give me a break.
They don't want legal immigration. They want illegal immigration because the legal immigrants tend to be patriotic and vote conservative. They don't want those.
And after what you've heard, this story that we presented to you today, and I'm reading it from BizPak Review. It's all over the place. You can get it anywhere where this guy is a terrorist. When they tell you there are no terrorists coming through the southern border in these caravans, tell them a terrorist is funding the caravan, not only in the caravan, but funding it. And see what they have to say about that. Morons, that's what I say. Speaking of moronic activity, we've got a transgender man. As I'll still say the way I want to say it, a tranny who's running to win Miss Universe, and she said it's a message, or he said it's a message to President Donald J. Trump. We're going to be talking about the fabric of the United States of America and where these libtards are bringing us down this dangerous path. Come on back to FOD. Welcome back to Freedom on Deck, your freedom show on your Freedom Sunday, on your Freedom Station, for your freedom points of views, which we express on a weekly basis for you and try to do our best job, and we thank you for being here. Go to freedomondeck.com, check us out. You won't be disappointed, unless you are one of those horrible libtards, and you might be. I'm talking about a tranny man. A tranny man. I will say it up and down. I'm not going to call it a transgendering woman or any of the PC stuff out there. He calls himself Angela Ponce, and he's a 2018 Miss Universe, and Spain, and he's favored to win the Miss Universe pageant on the 16th in Bangkok, Thailand. Okay. So, Ponce is 26 and the first transgender contestant in the Miss Universe pageant and poised to win by a large margin. This is according to reports from The Blast and the Daily Mail. And Ponce was born a male and underwent gender reassignment surgery. And Ponce says, if she wins, I maintain he intends to make the message known to President Donald Trump in particular at the world at large. And this is what Ponce said. As the competition nears, online bookies are taking action, and Ponce has grown to become, grown to become the clear favorite with current odds of 600. So she said, I have a message for President Trump. It would be a win for the human rights. Trans women have been persecuted and erased for so long. If they gave me the crown, it would show trans women are just as much women as cis women, which cisgender, I don't know if you guys know what that is.
Chet.
Nope.
Chet, what does President Trump have to do with trannies? Or
nothing.
Or homosexuality? Or anything?
Nothing.
Why do they keep accusing him of being anti-gay or and stuff like
if
that?
If she's running for Miss Universe, originally won Miss Spain and is a man and is a dude, forget about Donald Trump. Why don't you go over to Germany and walk the streets and see what happens to you? Because I guarantee you all those fantastic migrants that Angela Merkel brought in would have you thrown off a building immediately.
Right. Right. And all the real women that walk around over there have to hide their blonde hair under a hat.
You know, it's the thing that is really crazy is that it's not going to be too long in the future when somebody is going to be like that, is going to have that kind of surgery, and you're not going to know.
Oh, right.
You're going to be in a bar, or you're going to be in a
oh, it happens
store.
Already.
I know it happens. I'm just saying, but it's not going to be too long because with the hormones and with the surgeries and with everything else, you're just not going to know who's who. The future of our planet is a scary one.
And it's a mental disorder. I don't care what anybody tells me. If you're if you're born with twig and berries or you're born with a hoo-ha and you want something that God didn't give you, then you have a sickness, a mental illness.
Go into your doctor and say, you know what? Tell him that your left arm is really your leg and it's in the wrong spot, and tell him that you want your left leg put where your left arm is.
There are some
people, he'll have you at the psych ward so quick and make your head spin.
There are some people who think that their left arm doesn't belong in their body, so they have it amputated. For some strange reason, they have some kind of psychosis where they think their left arm isn't supposed to be on their body. Did you ever hear about that?
You laugh about this stuff.
It's
there
true.
Was this guy.
Yeah, it's gender dysmorphia.
This one guy. I was watching.
Oh, I'm sorry, not gender dysmorphia, but I mean
something dysmorphia.
It's like an appendage dysmorphia or something like that. Yeah, whatever. Yeah. There's a bunch of different ones, but
so this is all psychosis.
It was on E! News the other night, and it was. I don't know where it was. It was actually at one of these gaming events. This guy won something. He's the best gamer in the world. He's also a furry. Hold on. Let me tell the story, please. He's a furry. Do you know what furry is?
That's he has where, hair all over his
that's
body.
That's where you identify as an animal. They get together and they dress up as animals. He dresses up particularly as this hedgehog, and he's gay. And he gets up there and he starts talking about President Trump and how President Trump isn't for the furries, this, that, and the other. Yeah. And this is serious. They're putting him on the news, on E! News, which is not a serious network anyway, but they're actually airing this guy saying that Trump doesn't give equal equality to furries. This is the mental dysmorphia in this nation
right now.
Donald
Trump doesn't even know that there are furries.
Well, listen, what about... What,
I have a furry right
what
here.
About the, what about the young boy... Who's dressing in drag and getting on a stage, and they're giving and they're putting dollars up on the stage and handing them to him.
He's seven.
Out in Vegas.
He's seven. He was on Tosh.0.
Crazy.
This is satanic.
The big picture is that the Democrat Party are anti-God, and this is a rebellion against God. This is questioning God that he didn't make me what I was supposed to be. So I want to change what I am. It's a rebellion against God. Do you remember the 2012 Democrat convention where everybody booed when they tried to put God into their platform?
Oh, they booed.
Remember that?
Yeah, they booed when the police were brought up. They booed when they brought up the troops. They booed when they brought up God. Anything that's good, wholesome, and appeals to what America is supposed to be all about, the Democrats hate.
You lefties, you are sick!
And
you are sick!
And as much as I don't associate myself with the Republican Party because of the direction that they've gone down and the rhinos have gone down, I could never even think of ever voting for a Democrat, ever. There's no reason I would ever do it. And what people get offended when I say this is a sickness and this is only to destroy America, what they're doing here. And I know this is Miss Universe and this isn't happening in America, but this is happening worldwide. And this is happening in America at a far, it's an accelerated rate right now.
Sure.
What's happening, like what Brian said of the kid in Vegas, and I was talking about this furry. This is all to weaken us in order for the communist takeover. That's all it's all about. It's a globalist move.
Right. If you have a gun... We want to take away your guns. If you're a man, we want to make you a woman.
It's to turn anything on its head.
Yeah.
Santa Claus to be a gender neutral. You know, transgenders to compete in women's wrestling or women's track.
Yeah.
You know, what is right is to be wrong, and what's wrong is to be right.
Cuomo said America was never great. Cuomo.
Cuomo's great. No, he's not. America's great. But America's going in the direction of Cuomo. Sorry to tell you. Listen, come on back. We're going to be talking to Josh Landers, and we're going to be discussing this 9-year-old girl who committed suicide in Alabama. It's really disturbing stuff. You don't want to miss it. Freedom on Deck. No games played here. This is FOD on 94.9 News Now and Stimulating Talk. Me, Chet Martin, Brian Bro, and CB Burton all at the helm with you. WJJF on your FM dial. Connecticut, Long Island, and Rhode Island. Oh, yeah. Get pumped up on a Sunday. There's nothing wrong with it. Even though it's a holy day, you can have fun and you can listen to heavy metal. Don't worry about it. Take some time. Listen. Next up, we have our monthly spot featuring one of our great friends. It was supposed to be him and his lovely wife who's usually on with him, but today we just have Josh Landers from the Parent to Parent Network. Now, Josh, how you doing, man?
I'm doing well. Thanks for having me again, Chet.
Well, you know, we're going to get into more bullying and all that stuff. But before we do that, your wife took a trip up to the White House. She was supposed to meet the president. That didn't work out. But anyway, what was her trip like and what did it entail?
She had a great time. She was part of a contingent from the Maryland GOP team that was being honored for their service and efforts to help advance the Republican Party. They got a wonderful tour of the White House. Pictures taken next to Ronald Reagan. They actually got to see the stairs to the residence. Just had a great time hanging out and having a good time.
Good, excellent. Got some good pictures. I saw them on Facebook.
Absolutely.
All right, and do you know I was banned again? I'm banned on Facebook again, so I'll tell you about that later.
Serial criminal.
But listen, now everyone listening knows what you guys do with the Parent to Parent Network, and it's a fight back against the bullying epidemic occurring to our children throughout the country. The story I wanted to highlight was that of Mackenzie Adams, a 9-year-old little girl that was bullied at her Alabama elementary school, actually two schools. One she transferred from another one and actually was bullied there as well for her friendship with a white student. Mackenzie is black. Now, Josh, is there still a great amount of bullying happening out there due to racist views? Have you guys heard about anything like this?
Yes. Actually, I've been in the middle of a situation here in Baltimore where a high school student, a senior, who was white, was actually attacked by six black students for wearing a Confederate flag shirt. The young man who was wearing the shirt is just a history buff. He has not a racist bone in his body. Actually, his stepfather is black and his half-sister is black. But that didn't matter. Six students attacked him. The worst offense that occurred for any of those six students that attacked him was 2-day suspension. But when they interviewed him and patted him down, they found a Leatherman in his pocket, and he has now been transferred to an alternate school. So he is no longer allowed to go to his home school because he had a Leatherman in his pocket, which they say has, I don't know, a 1.5-inch blade somewhere in the Leatherman, and they consider that a deadly weapon. So, they've racial tensions are everywhere. I mean, they just are everywhere in schools. They are definitely coming out. It is wide and apparent on for all kids, black kids, white kids, Hispanic, Asian Americans, you name it. It's there.
And Josh, that could have easily had happened if he was wearing a Make America Great Again hat on, right?
It absolutely could have. Actually, we've got another student whose teacher is extremely anti-Trump and has actually included disparaging vocabulary words and sentences that you have to write about how bad the president is in his AP English class in another school just here in Baltimore. So, tensions are high, feelings are high. It could be disparaging remarks against the president. It could be differing political views. It could be the color of your skin. It's so much division, and it's a little bit of everywhere, and it is making the bullying even worse.
Josh, not that this has to do with the bullying, but was he, when he was patted down, was he was his parents present or his lawyer present? Do you know if that was the case?
No. Inside of the school SRO had asked for his permission, and he pulled everything out of his pockets to ensure they were going to let him go back to class, continue to wear the shirt, even though they knew that it had this potential feeling of being disrespectful because it was a Confederate flag, whatever that means. So they just checked to make sure he didn't have anything that he could use as a weapon, and he said, "No, I have nothing in my pockets," and he emptied them onto a table, and here we are.
Well, whatever that means liberalism is a mental disorder, and we know what's going on in our public schools. Now, Josh, going back to Mackenzie, when children that young are bullying a student over her friendship with someone of a different color, that has to be influenced at the home. That is not something that a child that's in fourth grade comes up with on their own. So when we're talking about that kind of influence at the home, when this is happening for over a year to this poor little girl, why does that go unchecked?
Chet, your thoughts or your ideas would be as good as mine. Again, the bullying epidemic that's come across the country is really how much schools and administrators are tolerating and expecting children to just learn how to behave better. They do not have the same influences at home. There is, you're correct in your assessment that, these type of things can be learned at home. We certainly see it from lots of folks that we speak with on both sides, both bullies and the ones that are being bullied. But this little girl, the school has failed, and it's just another example of how they are tolerating this behavior versus addressing and aggressively dealing with it. When you and I were in school, we might have talked about your shoes or your haircut,
mm-hmm.
but we didn't encourage you to go and kill yourself.
Right.
We didn't tell you that you were so ugly, we can't look at you and you should die, and tell you over and over and over again. And I can tell you from my upbringing, if any of the teachers that I was around would have heard that, I would have had a world of uncomfortableness from both the school and my parents, and it wouldn't have just gone away after that moment. It would have lasted a good long time, and I would have been strongly encouraged never to do that again. Well, the schools are essentially saying, we are going to tolerate this behavior, we are going to allow this behavior, and the kids know it. And they continue to push and push and push and push, and they... At 9 years old, they don't understand the weight and power of their words. And for this little girl at nine, and you know my son was nine when he was threatening suicide. So it is a very personal thing for me. I can only imagine how broken this little girl was. Those kids that were saying it don't understand the weight of their words. And no one's holding them accountable for it either. And that is the brokenness of our system. That is the brokenness of our education, the education system in the United States right now. And we are very hopeful that change will come. We are pushing for change, but individually, children need to stop. Parents need to become invested. Schools need to stand up and actually start following their own rule books. And until they do, unfortunately, we're going to have more McKenzies very soon. And that just breaks my heart.
You know, Josh, when this kind of outrageous bullying is happening throughout the school year, why isn't the faculty held responsible for her death? Because I've seen nothing about steps taken to stop the bullying when it was going on. So, it's not like they didn't see it happening. They did, obviously, because the aunt and the mother are talking about it throughout these articles that I'm reading from. And the aunt actually is a news reporter and is able to get the story out there now. And getting that story out there now is fine, but Mackenzie's gone now. It's too late. How many times are we going to have the faculty and the parents of the bullies that are inflicting this damage onto these children going unchecked until the child's no longer with us?
Amen. Chet, I wish I had an answer, but I can tell you what I know. What I know is that schools are doing these investigations. So if a student or a parent reports that bullying has occurred, the majority of the time, it is what they are considering he said, she said, and it is not corroborated. So they sweep it under the rug. If there is corroboration, if there is something that can reinforce that the child who's been bullied was correct in their statements, and this child said this. They are literally just having a sit down with the bully and talking to them about, you really shouldn't do this. And they can document all of this, that they went through these steps. Now, the majority of this is protected by FERPA. It's kind of like HIPAA, but it's for school records, and it keeps student educational records private. But the schools have gotten very good at this. For my son, they could say that they had all of these conversations, that they did all of these things. They can't tell me that, but if I ended up taking them to court, they could tell a judge this. And it's going to appear as if the school is invested and involved. The problem is that they are not actually doing anything about this. They are not taking drastic action. They are not involving the parents, the parents of the bully. They are not taking steps to remove the bullies from classrooms. They are not taking steps to remove the bullies from school, the ones that are actually doing damage and harm. And what they are teaching is essentially is tolerance. They're teaching kids that they are just going to have to suck it up and deal with it. And at 9 years old, you can only imagine how much armor they have to be able to withstand that type of attack on a daily basis, especially when it's happening because of your skin color or because of a friendship that you have. I mean, it kind of is counterintuitive to the things that we would want to teach our kids to do. And how to behave in society, right?
All right.
It's not going to change. These bullying reports here in Maryland, I can tell you that 82% of the reports that are submitted by students and parents and even teachers on some occasions are what they consider unfounded, meaning they don't have any evidence to support moving forward with change or the student being removed from a classroom or the student being removed from the school and actually going through a process of suspension or expulsion. That's a tremendous amount. It doesn't mean that it's not happening. It just means that the schools have become very good at documenting and covering their own asses. And I don't know another way to say it.
We have Josh Landers from the Parent to Parent Network, and you can check them out on their Facebook page at Parent to Parent Network. You can go and message them there. They're more than willing to talk to anyone out there listening whose child or grandchildren are going through this type of thing. Now, Josh, we got a couple minutes to go, and you're going to come back with us, but I wanted to ask you one more thing. Do you guys get a lot of reports on cyberbullying? Is that a real big epidemic right now? Because it seems to me like the kids go to school, they get bullied, and then they go home and get bullied on the internet.
It is the second fastest growing segment of bullying. So beyond sexual harassment and sexual assault, it is the next fastest growing category. We have a parent here in Maryland whose daughter was cyberbullied to the point of committing suicide. Her name is Christine McComas, and her daughter's name is Grace. They've actually had laws passed here in the state of Maryland for cyberbullying that are fairly aggressive and intentional, and the police are able to because there is tracking and tracing and some level of documentation that's done. There have been a number of children that have been caught and prosecuted. Not the volume of children that are actually doing it.
Yeah.
Kids are definitely figuring out how to do it younger and earlier. We have another student from a neighboring county whose 12-year-old daughter was cyberbullied and then was assaulted on a bus. She was struck in her head 37 times while one of the bullies or the suspect friends videotaped it. And that night, she posted it on Instagram and Snapchat.
Unreal.
And the police department got involved. They told the parent to remove the child's access to social media. The next day, the child actually opened 5 new pseudo accounts and posted the video again, bragging.
Of course.
It's become just as intense and as frightening to children as face-to-face bullying or bullying that's occurring within schools.
When something like that happens, they should be put into juvenile hall, and that's my opinion on that, Josh. Now, listen, we're going to come back, Josh, and you're going to stick around with us because we're going to be talking about the Adam Lanza situation with these documents being released to public. And everybody come on back to Freedom on Deck. We're having a roundtable. And Josh Landers from Parent to Parent is sticking with us. And we're going to be talking about Adam Lanza. Come on back.
Devil without a cause. And I'm back with the beaver hats and Ben Davis slacks. 30-pack of strolls. 30-pack of hoes. No road gain in the propane flows.
Welcome back to FOD 94.9 News Now and Stimulating Talk. It's been another fantastic show, and we appreciate you being here with us on your Sunday. And Josh Landers from Parent to Parent Network has stuck around with us. Josh, thanks for coming back, man.
Absolutely.
Before we start up on Adam Lanza, tell everybody where they can go check out Parent to Parent, because we didn't do that in the last segment. So do that for our audience.
Check us out on Facebook. It's Parents Against School Violence at Parent to Parent Network. We got a couple thousand members. We'd love to have more. If you have questions or concerns about rules, or you're having issues with bullying, please feel free to reach out. We have our email addresses located on there, but you can also reach out to my wife or I privately through a private message through Facebook. We'll be more than happy to do what we can to help.
Now, Josh, one of the reasons I really wanted you to be on with us, because you have a child with autism, and what we're talking about right now is the 1,000 pages of documents revealing the Sandy Hook shooter, Adam Lanza, and his dark descent and what happened with Adam. And he had a lot of, he was a recluse, a lot of time spent playing these violent video games. He had a lot of feelings of being sympathetic towards pedophilia. He had a lot of feelings of being outwardly angry at anybody that didn't look like him. And this was something that was monitored throughout his school years and never addressed. And his mother didn't really do a good job with that as well. She let him sit in the basement, kind of be alone, play these violent games, only talk to people through the internet. He didn't socialize with anyone else, and he had autism. You see this as like kind of a perfect storm, Josh, for this kid to turn out to be this violent mass shooter?
Yes, I certainly do. I absolutely think that parents leaving the children and letting them fall into their own little world, especially with the different diagnoses that Adam Lanza had, is absolutely setting up, a potential explosion at a later date. You know, as a parent with a child with autism, I am trying to draw my son into the world with all of its challenges. And my son is sensitive to sound and certainly doesn't understand social cues. And my job and my role as his father is to draw him up to the place where he can inject into the world. And what my interpretation is that Adam's mother did not draw him towards the world. She almost let him create his own world,
right,
and fall further into his obsessive compulsive disorder. And from the writings and some of the journaling that he did, it just became more intense and more intense, and it was unchecked. And it's like building a bomb that's going to explode. It is not addressed early and often and with tremendously big hearts and lots of intentionality.
And from what we're seeing, he was seeking counseling from the school counselors. They knew about, they knew his makeup, right? So a lot of times what happens, and we talk about it with you guys all the time, is these schools, we don't always blame them, because a lot of the time they're overwhelmed with students and they're not able to get on top of things like this. And then it leads into when this kid's 20 and he goes up and shoots up a preschool in Sandy Hook.
Very much so, Chet. It really speaks to, it's the parent's responsibility. It is responsibility for my son. If the school does not have the resources available or doesn't have the ability to affect a change for that young man, they need to be on the phone with me. And I need to be the one taking the lead in the charge. I mean, if we look at the parents of Nicholas Cruz, his mother, she didn't do a whole lot other than just call the police. Now, that certainly didn't help their situation down in Parkland, but it's a similar situation for Adam and his mother. If she's not taking the onus of responsibility to teach Adam better social skills, to teach him tolerance for people that were a little heavier than he was, or if they had any weight to them whatsoever, mm-hmm. or if they didn't look a certain way. Well, that's a responsibility of a parent to teach the child. And because he didn't have the natural intuition to understand that people are different and that doesn't make them bad, well, that's my responsibility as a parent to teach my son. I lean on Adam's mother for that same purpose. Parents need to be invested and involved. We cannot depend on the schools to raise our children or to fix our kids when there's screws loose or tweaking needs to be done. It's the parents' job. Schools can be a resource, but they cannot be the one driving that to occur. Does that make sense?
Oh, yeah. All great. Go ahead, Steve.
No, I'm just about to say that his mother paid the ultimate price, you know?
Well, yeah.
For her mistakes. And he also had that disease where he saw other people as just cardboard cutouts with no real value at all. And once that's diagnosed, shouldn't a person like that be institutionalized?
I do believe so. You know, obviously, I'm not a medical professional. We do have a teacher here in Maryland that has an eight-year-old student that was brought from an institution after 60-day observation for attempting to commit murder to the student's younger sibling. And this teacher was terrified because she saw no emotion in the eyes of the child. That's terrifying to me. At 8 years old, obviously, it requires intensive treatment. And there's no saying that that child's not going to come back, but they need to be in a very restricted environment. They need to have very intensive therapeutic intervention from lots of folks with PhDs and MDs after their names. And it's for the protection of all society, not just the children in the school. This particular child at 8 years old tried to throw his younger sibling out a window. Mm. At 8 years old, it blows my mind. So to your point, CD, yes. And that requires a lot of evaluation. It's a really hard choice in the decision. But we're talking about the protection of an entire school. And for this young man, for the protection of his mother and father and his younger sibling, why are we not looking at that, dealing with that? Does that make sense?
That makes total sense. Hey, listen, Josh, thank you for sticking around with us for that one, too, man. You gave us a lot of insight considering your son has autism. And we need to get a hold of it, and we need to stop the bullying out there. And everybody check them out on Parent to Parent. At Parent to Parent on Facebook, and you can message Josh or his lovely wife, Nicole, and they're willing to talk to anybody about anything, anytime, any place having to do with your kids. So listen, come on back next week. We're going to be talking to John Milkovich. He's a Democrat state senator in Louisiana and the author of Robert Mueller, Errand Boy of the New World Order, and also our good buddy Xander Gibbs going to be bopping on by X-Rad. Come on back to FOD.